Undergoing change, which is going to force us to think again about some of the things that we do in research and policy and elsewhere. So I'm going to talk about some work that a governor of the State of the National Bioethics Council, and we were asked in late 2012 to think what happens to medical ethics in a world of cloud-based health records and pervasive genomics. And to the council, which is a charity funded by note, when you look at this hotel, a lot of the things I observed is that you can check the offloads are very reminiscent of the offloads from Facebook. If you go to the Chelsea to find the mechanisms of Facebook, you'll observe that every year or so, once 20 or 25% of Facebook users will set up non-default privacy settings to stop the advertisers getting their stuff. But the change of all the mechanisms and obstacles in the back end, then you have to struggle to find where the user controls are and how you operate. And it's interesting to see what happens there, because if you graph the number of people who opt out, it's across this red bar. Right? And it doesn't suggest that being engineered is that more people become sensitized to privacy issues and more people who opt out. Now, if you can understand why in a commercial business like Facebook, where you're not the customer but the product, and the customer is the advertiser, that things are organized in this way. But why should they be organized in this way on the health service? And that's not because it says out there in scandal. In the 1990s, the government started collecting something called hospital statistics, the head of decibels. Every time you go into a hospital for treatment, whether inpatient or outpatient, there's a billing record created to start your health service to your treatment. And the summary of this system, the bogey name of that, for which you take your data first, with diagnostic code, treatment code, teaching physician, and so on, which is written to the head data. The idea is that this is used to monitor insert quality outcomes, time the number of nurses, and some of the quality. In April last year, the relevant body revealed that head data has been sold to 1,200 universities, firms, and others since 2013. And as noted, the headline B is easily accessible, easily contained in the code for the first. Is this information anonymous? Well, the Department of Health claimed it was, and NGOs made a complaint to the Information Commissioner, who said to the Department of Health, and he got to say, the Department of Health said, sorry, this is anonymous information, it's just not the Information Commissioner, the Information Commissioner agreed. Which is quite a good area for people who are interested in policy or data protection law and so on. Now, here's an interesting question. Suppose you were to encrypt the headline, this is after I spoke on the subject back in 1990, a master's book was actually shut down by the Old Supreme Court. What happens if you give a database where you can get some inquiries saying, show me all the questions to underwent a cardiovascular intellectual fibrillation in Hamilton Hospital from March 19th, 2003. That's all that's going well. And once you know it's encrypted in the headline, then of course you can look for all the other episodes of care, which is what we've seen. There's an interesting point here, which is that a medical record can be part of a few public facts linked to the identity of the individual, which can possibly serve private facts. So you cannot anonymize this kind of data to provide encryption to the net. That's the point that the Department of Health has always refused to learn. But then it's very difficult to get people to learn something if they're in their job because they're not understanding. There's a number of vigorous advocates for anonymization, for government's chief scientific advisor, who used to run the work of that, and both Tim Felton, who runs the relevant part of the NHS, he advised David Cameron and his policy before that, to let the Nana Health Fighting Company. So, to this background, with quite unsatisfactory section 5 in secondary use and abuse, we've got a further problem, which is that we're going to have DNA. Under the last government, the UK Department of Health launched the 100,000 genome project, which will basically use sequencing to provide data to support both selection and research. Initially, it will be used largely in cancer treatment, but the last instrument will be sequenced. So that is an old excuse for it. And it's been used in monitoring and dealing with genetic diseases. And the deal here is but if you use this new system, entirely centralized, it can consent, not just to the use of the existing system, but also for its use in detail, to help limit its time thereafter, to help the opportunity to operate. And this means that the objective is to show, with all the departments of health partners, including partners who overseas, such as the Silicon Valley Company in 2021. This was presented in 2013 from offering health advice to new customers. Since the election, the record of the record has now changed, and all has now been successful. We have the genetic test. It's no longer a matter of doing wet chemistry or something like that. And once you start thinking of all the things that can go wrong, once you've centralized the database with everybody, it's just a matter of writing a small script to identify the ones that stand for stores, and these first certificates and attributions to humanity. And perhaps another small script to amend the first certificates. These are the sort of issues that one has to think about. So, this is the background, or part of the background, for the Matthew report. And while we, once we have started writing it, we've found a report from the Presidential Council of Advisors in Science and Technology, which involves people like Microsoft, Chris Mundy, and Google Dollar Trip. Their view of this, which is now the US official government view, is that big data has its big components. The first one is the collection of data, which can far be all or heavy data, which does speak from just the recognition, collects data and with this type of. Then there's the processing and aggregation, which is done by firms like Microsoft and Facebook. And as many of the systems that close to by the multi-value cloud, that Microsoft actually lasts longer. And then finally, the leap is the choice of violence. Now, the view taken by TTAC is a whole new approach to this today. And the interesting thing was that the sort of leap of this from here, the European Court of Justice decided otherwise, and it decided that aggregators like Google do it at times to use it under the rules of the law. So that's the core of the problem. Now, what we need to do is to do research and testing, and for that matter, to do the science. Well, for most of it's long been accepted that the world's boundaries are going to be wide. And right, there are some things that are treated by the criminal law, there are more things treated by civil law, things to which we can be practical, there are things to which we can do. But the proper course of action for a doctor is more constrained still, and there's a whole bunch of things that we can do without being practical to do, but which you can't do. Because if you do these things, you need to use the practical session. And the care of that particular patient is better, and the care of patients generally is better. And so we have a couple of sentences to do. And then there's lots of long-term to discussion. So here's the question. What is an ethical approach to medical practice and medical research in a world where too many people have too much information? Where you've got cloud-based health records, where you've got genomics, where you've got government structures that don't work properly, for all the reasons people can use it in politics, because it's difficult to use it in lobbying, part of interest groups, globalization, because of technical architectures not aligning with social expectations, because of all these things. And that is why the Matthew Bioethics Center set up this project. So, what are the problems? This week, you've got lots more data. You have got cloud-based primary and secondary care records. In the UK, doctors need to keep new records in their pleasure and take these files in the field. Then the government made them an offer that they couldn't refuse. Who will pay for your computer? The doctors foolishly said yes. Since then, there has been a steady migration of data from the doctor's surgery who loves to have a farm and buy that one. Really. But in that process, you know, last week, and only a relatively small number of people have had to be shifted to their own premises. And of course, the government has become customer for the software companies. The software that we've written is optimized more for administrative requirements than for direct software, which brings secondary issues of social reusability to our customers using the phrase to know. Second, the genomics. And genetic information doesn't just lead to information about you, but about your years and years. You don't have to sequence everybody in population in order to know more relevant genetic facts about what you do. Then you look at person generated stuff. People have put this, you have got iWatches, they've got all sorts of devices that are used to monitor activity, gear, calorie fun. And of course, people have more use to all sorts of different applications, and in order to try and get better at that information, it is called sold because that's how these companies make their money. Some of the things like communication data, the location for people with mobile phones. One of the key questions in privacy law in the UK is Tangle versus Mirror. When we model Naomi Tangle, a snap from somebody from the Daily Mirror, the Mirror said that the photograph is a public space and so there was no expectation of privacy. Naomi Tangle was served by thought otherwise, because the fact that she had been to such a meeting revealed some part of the information about her. When the patient gets to use a mobile phone, similarly revealed from the highly private information. Who all have access to that information? And then, of course, there are those sort of legislative custody orders that come here about the Zip Act, particularly for the intelligence services, what is more or less understood access to the project for all sorts of purposes. Personal health information has clearly been confirmed on that. And it's just about everything in the world that costs you more than $10, you don't need to get as far as keeping your communication. There will be massive and massive and massive of communication data collected by all sorts of firms and all sorts of apps. The Google Glass has worked, for example, when the economy data has revealed what the graphics are, so what passes we need to access for how long, and even more intimate history of thoughts and attachments to doing your fixes. At the same time, we're getting enormously more capability to store important sorts of information. And we're seeing an awful lot of these models, which are based on mashing this information up and breaking down what used to be silos and putting together information in recombinant ways that can be used to sell more stuff. How do you keep track of all this? The second thing is that it will take care of the hype up. And most of us who've worked in this industry for a while are familiar with the data hype cycle. And from something that's been talked about with big data is at the moment, your policy is still on the top of it. These people are mostly art graduates, but they're terrified of these students and the tech program. It's really only tech. You can stand up to the big man in the world of child quality. And at the same time, there are all sorts of financial drivers. Easy availability of venture capital finds innovation in the private sector, the desire to save money inside the public sector, to come together with people who are the ministers of all sorts of crazy ideas to do this. And we start to get a break with the centralizing tendency of every bureaucracy. National systems are all the way. And one of the perpetual games we fight for is to mind up the basic figures of new ways to go. This is all driving things in the direction. At the same time, open data is being interpreted by industries such as Big Pharma as being the ability for open access to allow research for innovation. And at the same time, medical researchers add more voice to the panel. In fact, any medical researcher in Cambridge will probably replicate the fundamental human right to have on their laptop all the medical records
four people in Britain for suffering from the disease that we and it's very, very difficult to argue against. I still hear one about it, everybody wants it. And then I get to anonymization. For the past 30 years, the first minister has tried to believe very, very hard with anonymization. And they have thought that if you just call people's names on exactly what the record, then everything will be fine. As they see, that's not the case. But it's not when you can link up successes, how have the first response to this individual, because some of these are usually public, to everyone, to the celebrity, or to the people that care about it, to the private individual, and the source can then be linked up to other events for that source, then the full purpose of medical private individual. I've got a chapter in my book on this, and to give you talks that range from the details of this, as well as the society of the industry. If you want all the brutal details of how you feel about the anonymized and the identifying stuff, just step out of that thing. So, what sort of platform can we try and stand on in the midst of all this confusion? Well, how about going back to basic moral philosophy? And we can go right back to ancient Greece, and probably before, and we find that there's a clear distinction drawn between public and private. And in fact, we see the same thing even in animal behavior. And animals clearly feel guilty or frightened about some things we do. What dominant males trying to make and their children do to communicate with these things. First of all, we look at beaten up by the dominant male. So this is large, this is a solution for Julian to deal with. Anthropologists tell us that bonds of disclosure are important, and we learn a little bit about the best thing you might think to see society. And they're important to perform and maintain our identity of our relationships. Who you tell what is one of the definitions of intimacy. Releasing more and more information about yourself to somebody that you get to know better is part of the bonding process. Similarly, for so provided we have people identifiable as doctors, roughly speaking, in ancient Greece, consent is how patient relationships work. That's the practical, norms around surgery. If you chop my finger off, then it's like research for surgery, and otherwise, it's going to create a bodily harm. That is something that is established millennia ago. And then, of course, you've got other things such as public health and research. But it's important to realize that these aren't just in simple positions to try to think that the company it's much more complex than that. And these things are often complement trials and substitutes. The next thing that you can look at is the foundation of law and government. David Field. We have in modern societies laws rather than ruled by the priests of a ruler, and the laws reflect an emerging social consensus. Okay, it's just fine, and there are various biases, but this is how we govern ourselves as a species. And there's a number of things that we can find in law which are really rather intense. Firstly, there's the common law just to be confident. If I tell you something confidentially, and if that, then I will have an action against you as well. You then get the data protection law, which is back ultimately to the 1960s, which concerns about mainframes. And this is founded in human rights law, which is where at least to some extent is after World War II for the European Convention on Human Rights. Now, Section 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights gives us a right to privacy, and the relevant case law in the UK times in Finland. At this time, the nurse who was working at the University Hospital of Helsinki, and she was HIV positive. And the systems of that hospital left all the clinicians to the only patient's work, despite the work that was under the previous government here. And therefore, her colleagues at the nursing station found out that she was HIV positive, and they basically had her out of her job. So she sued for compensation. The court in Finland said, nope, the authorities and government made their own regulations about how this could be managed by the climate. if you went to Stanford and the judges in Stanford or the Congress in court and said, in fact, that the citizens of Europe have the right to restrict our personal health information to those people who are involved directly. And that was the same law formulated at September 2010. And that's why David Cameron has to offer everybody the right to opt out of the central data collection, because otherwise it would be a clear breach of the Federal Human Rights Act. And there was basically no way that the user could get that, not even if we bring in a British Bill of Rights, because the CHR and the Council of Europe are the user and the sponsor Anonymization, as you've seen, doesn't work. It's sort of very specified circumstances. And consent is becoming steadily harder. Because given the enormous range of things that you've done with your research process, with what you've been doing so far, I think you need to give consent to all that stuff. The European law, consent, informed and deliberate, and you have to make enough information available to the subject at the time that they hand over the information so they can reasonably put the old things into the context. And if you're a company like Google keeping track of for years and thinking out all sorts of tools you're using, you just basically can't reach that far. So there are problems coming down the track here. Growing attention, seeing where our technology is going, and the really probably entrenched aspects of constitutional law. And we can see some of the subjects fight for the data protection regulation in the European Parliament over the next year, but that's not going to be all of it by any means. So, if you're a researcher rather than an NGO faculty and activist, what can you do in the time being? Well, let me come up with the four principles which, if applied scrupulously, to deal with the issues. The first is respect the purpose. The set of expectations about how data is used from the data initiative should be grounded in the principle of respect for persons, including recognition of a person's profound moral interest in controlling others' access to and disclosure of information relating to them. Held in circumstances that regard as confidential. In other words, you cannot keep people's personal information as an industrial raw material. This is a fundamentally different sort of input from, say, a shipload of oxygen. Now, much of the big data is about denying this. I'm pretending that you can just pull in a petabyte here and an exabyte there, and that's the first day of the next 200 million in the line. So that's just an ethical way to do research about the business. If it's not going to be a constant information, and nowadays more and more information is constant. So if it's contaminated with constant information, sensitive constant information can be produced from it, such as your exhibits and the public phenomenon. Human rights. The set of expectations about how data was used in the data should be determined with regard to established human rights. Why? Because that's what we've got, that's the outcome of the legislative and historical dialogue about science that has been and between ourselves for over the past few generations. And if you're going to just imagine that the law doesn't apply to you, then with these guys, where the rather fine tax here would actually prove up. And this includes limitations on the power of states and others to interfere with the privacy of citizens and public interest, including protect the interests of others. Human rights law is a big and complex thing, There are some parts of it that apply to services, particularly applications such as similar stuff. There are other things that cause systems like to pick up, but in people actually help. Very, very hard to change and deliberate and sort of set constitutions. These are machines, but they're deliberate and designed to the core of the machine. And if you get a part of the system, if you get a 9-11, if you get an electrical upgrade, you can't just tear up everything that makes it work. In other words, it's quite convenient that might be just a dying fire at the time. Principle 3 of participation. The chapter that sets questions about how data will be used and reused in data initiatives, and the appropriate measures and procedures to ensure that those expectations are met, should be determined with the participation of people with morally relevant systems. In the old days, if you were doing a psychology experiment or a clinical trial, you could get thought and thought and sense, time, and ability to participate. Now, if you're using population scale data, particularly if you're reusing stuff, that's why things do not have to be. But there's an awful lot of stuff that you can do. You can speak to it with a full range of relevant systems and that's all representative. Now, government is very, very bad at this. There are cabinet office rules about consultants or principals and investigations. But of course, civil servants speak to it with these offices. They want to stand out to the stakeholders in the industry for lobbying, of course. And so very often, regulations are made with a small panel of people sitting around the table. To break the public or to break the cross-party regulations in the city. Now, you can do that if you're in medical research. You've got to speak to it if you do a reasonable number of representative users, self-assured surveys, whatever methods and mechanisms are appropriate, and that you can find out what people would actually think of the research agreement for data as you follow the strategy. And of course, one of the things that we're trying to do here is to not fill the front page there. If what you're doing appears on the front page of the Guardian, 3 days before you buy the book, it's going to destroy your world online. Right? If it will destroy your world, then you're not going to destroy it. And principle 4 principles is accounting for decisions. A data initiative should be subject to effective systems of governance and accountability before it's solved, morally justified. And that means structures of accountability are important to legitimate judicial and political authority, which is dealing with the health service, with various regulations and boards and oversight groups and so on. But you also need social accountability arising from engagement with people in society. It's not enough to get an awful lot of carbon cost to make that a day on the 5th of the committee of scholars and which went out and consider it a problem solved. If you then go and sell people's medical records to 400 different organizations worldwide, if you get melt one and disappears at some place in the Guardian, then you didn't do it right. And of course, more as a security guy, I'm really interested in breach recording. If you can only improve the world, if you can know when stuff has gone wrong. As the Americans have really fallen the march on this, because there's a huge support of technology in this space. It seems that if you need people to pass their information, you've got to start. And the EU has avoided that right away, that's for the British government. In France, $5, for example, how many security breaches there have been involving people basically calling up health authorities and hospitals and so on, depending on the insight that they're getting people to look up castings on PDF, that's the common phone book. Which is just everybody's name and address, the phone number being ex-directed in the country. And this is the result that we misuse if you're a private detective and you're going to call the tax company. This is the one problem you have for 20 years ago. So, anything to go report to the station, is there any central reporting to the Department of Health? The officials told us it's green, but no central records are kept. So, you have to go and contact every single individual NHS organization. And to see them in connection with that, you know, it's a problem. Why is it that officials and ministers simply don't want to know what's going on? Well, that's not an ethical way of doing business. So you have to have mechanisms of accountability that communicate clearly the government's execution and control to the people who are affected. If you try to avoid it, if you try that, you're not going to go and you're not going to do it. How do existing initiatives add up? Well, mostly not very well. Care and care about data, peak data, and industrial raw materials are still at all. Well, and even for some customers, it's the most of the use license. Which means that there are some who can go to the new cell with new medical equipment. We're completely outside of the kind of things that are still outside of the cell, and we won't tell you who the cell is worth at all. The cost of research estimates, which they have definitely anonymized, and this is the total cost of research costs. This is the same CPRD, which is incorporated by that gold effort, after not making clinical study reports in terms of any of the topics. So they're publishing the things that this is not published, namely the record, and they're not publishing the things that they should publish, namely filtered. Nice one. Why does that happen? Well, if you look at the past now of the CPR, you can see it has been an executive director as far as systematic consultants. What do you think my chances would be if I just didn't get my executive job next time to notify? Well, I
will probably respond in time to the medical device safety aspect of all of this stuff.
Government? Okay. Under the Health and Genome Project, well, at least genetic things and keep custody of the data. One day, database for 100 people. But they allow secret uses by phones, and they won't be accountable for them if you saw that. But it's very bad because it makes local database intercepting the central state data on some public engagement that's a long way from the ideal. Okay, what about elsewhere? Well, we're actually using these principles here at the lab. I'm calling panel analysis director, who has got a system called Device Analyzer, and it runs an app on quality of phone, kind of essentially sells an Android phone. And this basically monitors what is on your phone. It gives some benefits to users in terms of custom analytics, which shows what is the best phone plan for you within the app view. From our point of view, it lets us understand smartphone use, energy consumption, kind of a fine, you know, we can correlate what we have on the phone, the different vulnerabilities that we discover, and so on and so forth. And there's a website which people are reminded of once a month, which is basically for the research technical just moving with information. So, you know, set for feedback of your internet. And so this is something like a field file that stores what we ethical principles are constantly set forward to implement in practice. You know, this is not under political pressure, as medical research tends to be, to pretend that it doesn't matter. Applications of law enforcement. Well, we're having a big debate at the moment about how we can do with surveillance and the way of exploding revelations. So the Anderson Institute reported last week that proposals to greatly simplify authorization of last action communications data collection and to improve reporting and transparency. Law enforcement, at least some sort of from the special services, intelligence services, and so on. And law enforcement is, of course, as a function of the state and by human rights law. And in an ideal world, you'd be able to impose the ethical conditions. And law enforcement and a really ideal role as an intelligence agency as well. It's called the spread one, which is what the service of the South North by 6-7. And here's a couple of interesting reports that I picked from the economist that before I got here on the 7th of February after the report tonight. If citizens aren't protected from crying out, some will suffer and others from their back. Scientists will have to develop new norms and companies won't have to balance crime to inflation. Governments will have to define what is acceptable. Every extra year, smartphones have changed the world, and they have hardly begun. So where is it going? The EU, this is worth remembering for the economy, is not just the two brains, one on the head and one on the hand. It has a third, powerful brain, telepathic and shared by all. that may yet be to touch the world back before it becomes a person. And that's the next way. And democracies may be able to find acceptable solutions to some of the problems of course. That's what I hate to say, but well, meanwhile, what we do is, well, we switch away from the holding ethical cycle of expectations. But then we can go there. So for more, you can get the report on our blog on my website, blog.likely.com.org, my website is blog.com. And we have a workshop next week where we discuss these things among others, which can delve into problems of economic and information security. But this is an issue that we run. For example, giving attention to the stock and investment research efforts committee to Chelsea. I gave it to the Legion Medics last month. I gave it to students to serve in September. Well, this is one of the issues that lots and lots of people have tried to be concerned about. And so, we want to do the material here before, to serve every sort of example of the discussion.